Good afternoon. It's time now. The meeting will begin. Our meeting this time has been postponed to work with the schedule of the relevant government officials. We'll now invite the relevant government officials into the room to walk us through the paper. Welcome, Secretary for Housing. It's your first time attending this meeting today. We have with us Ms. Winnie Ho Wing-Yin, Secretary for Housing, Mr. Donald Ng, Deputy Secretary for Housing, and Ms. Winnie Wong, Director Sales of First-Hand Residential Properties Authority of Housing Department. The Housing Bureau has submitted the paper. Perhaps, Secretary, you can walk us through the paper with the aid of the PowerPoint presentation. Thank you, members. Thank you, Madam Chair. It's my first time attending this panel meeting today. I will focus on briefing members on policies on providing public housing to grassroots families. Our public housing policy has been providing affordable rental housing to the needy to help low to middle income families gain access to home ownership, which has formed a solid foundation for the stable development of our society. Public rental housing has a notable impact on poverty alleviation. Grassroots households allocated with PRH will not only enjoy significant improvements in their living environment, but also benefit from reduced housing expenses, thereby increasing their disposable resources. That's why, over the years, the Housing Bureau has done a lot of work in stabilizing the development of our society. We understand that the problems of public housing are of public's concern. Our team has come up with a number of strategies to subvert the situation. So in 2020 policy address, we have come up with different policies to cope with the housing problem. You may be familiar with the light public housing initiative. We recommend that in the coming 5 years, from 2023 to 2024 to 2027 to 2028, provide around 30,000 light public housing units. Also, we plan to substantially increase public housing supply. Based on the latest projection of the long-term housing strategy, the public housing demand for the coming 10-year period is 301,000 units. The government has identified sufficient land for providing about 360,000 public housing units. In the coming 5 years, the supply for public housing is tight. So we are trying to come up with different ways to enhance quality and quantity and also efficiency. We hope to increase public housing to 158,000 units. And together with about 105,000 light public housing units, we hope to boost the public housing supply compared to the previous 5 year period, which was about 105,000 units. It is a 50% increase. With light public housing units, we're also enhancing quantity, speed, efficiency, and quality of traditional public housing units. So we're introducing a new index of composite waiting time for subsidized rental housing. So you'll have two sets of figures for your reference to find out the average waiting time for public housing. We hope to, by 2026, reduce the average waiting time for PRH to 4.5 years. We also plan to roll out the PRH advance allocation scheme. Due to land supply problem, the traditional land supply for public housing will be less than the previous 5 years. So we have to think of how to enhance quantity. Apart from adding a 30,000 light public housing units, we are trying to look for room to boost supply as well. For example, some of the development projects will be rolled out in phases. About 20,000 units will be completed earlier, by about 3 to 18 months for people for earlier intake of applicants. Also, regarding allocation of public housing, in the past, we issued an occupation permit 3 months before the intake. Now we are expediting the allocation process and will issue the permit 6 months before intake so that applicants or residents can make relevant arrangements in advance. In enhancing speed of building public housing, apart from using traditional construction or assembly methods, we are promoting the use of modular integrated construction approach, that is MIC approach. That is, some of the components will be prefabricated before transporting to the sites, and they are volumetric prefabricated parts. And our target is, in the next 5 year period, half of the projects will see the use of MIC approach. We also accelerate housing production by the adoption of design and build model. We will combine the contracts of super infrastructure construction works and other construction works in one contract so that the contractor will be responsible for more work processes. For example, when foundation works are carried out, super infrastructure works or plan vetting of plan will be conducted in parallel. Interdepartmental collaboration is important in public housing production. Different departments are involved, including CEDD, as well as Drainage Services Department or Water Supplies Department, as well as Fire Services Department. We need the collaborative effort of different departments in building a public housing or completing a public housing project. And we will coordinate the efforts of different government departments to make sure that the whole process will be conducted smoothly. We'll also make use of private market forces to enhance speed and quantity. We will introduce a new pilot scheme on private developer participation in subsidized housing development. Hopefully, by the first quarter of 2023, we'll be able to provide more details on the policy framework. Under this scheme, by the next financial year, we will put up 3 sites for a tender for private developers to build subsidized sale flats, and it will be sold to eligible persons at specified discount rate from the market prices. And these flats will be opened for application by eligible persons. And those who are interested in participating in the scheme, they are also encouraged to apply for rezoning of private land owned by them. And they'll also enjoy some discounts. And they will be sold at specified discount rate. Our preliminary thought is that we will not recover the land in a specified rate And the developers will have to make sure that they have measures in place to sell the units in certain price or rate. The policy initiatives mentioned just now are those to solve public housing problems. As you know, the building of traditional public housing also takes time. So we have several measures in place to alleviate the hardship of grassroots families, including transitional housing and also tenancy control on subdivided units and cash allowance trial scheme. Transitional housing was proposed in 2017, and under Housing Bureau, there's a task force to coordinate the relevant work. And we have enough land to produce 20,000 transitional housing units, of which about 5,500 units have been put into operation. And it's expected that by the end of this year, about 1,500 units are expected to be completed. So in total, there will be 7,000 units. And we are also inviting tenders for some of the projects. And for some of the projects, we have just been given funding. And we're also studying the feasibility for some other projects. So the transitional housing units will be completed in phases. The Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance came into effect on the 22nd of January 2022. And those who are renting subdivided units, this ordinance will provide protection to them. And the ordinance also makes sure or prohibits landlords from overcharging tenants on utilities or other services. And the rating and valuation departments, as well as water supplies departments, are working to step up publicity on tenancy control. For the cash allowance trial scheme, starting from June 2021, there has been a 3-year cash allowance trial scheme in place to provide cash allowance to those who are not living in public housing and not receiving the CSSA and have waited for PRH for more than 3 years, but have not been offered the first PRH allocation to relieve their pressure or financial burden on renting private housing. And in total, we have disbursed around 2.27 billion to about 81,300 eligible households, and will now welcome members for questions. We have a number of members who have pressed the button to speak, including Doreen Kong, Lam Chun Sing, Tam Fei, Stanley M, Man Yu, Bill Tan, Luk Chung Hong, and myself. We only have one discussion item today. Each of us will have 5 minutes. Let's start with Doreen Kong. Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Secretary. I have a number of questions. You mentioned that in the next 5-year period, you will build 30,000 light public housing units. So if you have to reach this target within 5 years, that means you have to build by phase each year 20 blocks of residential units. That means each year you have to build 6,000 units. Over the past 1 or 2 years, for transitional housing, there are about 5,500 transitional housing units completed. Why are you so sure that each year you will be able to complete at least 6,000 residential units? That means 20 residential blocks. Also, on site selection for all the light public housing units, do you have specific sites in mind? If not, when will you release the list of sites for light public housing units? Also, on private and public partnership, who will be responsible for the cost Secretary, please.
Secretary, thanks very much, Madam Kong. I've also looked at the speed of building these light public housing. I am comparing this with transition housing. This was announced in 2017. It would be 4 years, and we have 20,000 in 7 years' time. Now we have 5 years, in fact, 4 years odd to do 30,000. So we are 2.5 times faster this time. Why is it we're confident that we will be able to do it? From commencement of work to completion, transitional housing is pretty efficient. They are using MIC. Now for the light public housing, they have a standardized design, and the MIC can standardize them the design. We're using the ASD's team, and the ASD has got the experience behind behind them with regard to the mixed shift accommodation. In 4 years' time, they have built about 20,000, and they also have the experience of provisional hospital. In 4 months' time, they built a transitional hospital on Lantau. Now, we also have the advanced work undertaken. The transitional housing is undertaken by the NGOs. They put in the application. They are the landlords. They hire the architects to vet the plans, and then they call for tender. And we have a dedicated team in the government here for this light public housing. The advanced work can be compressed in its timing. Very soon, we'll be coming back to the council for funding application. With the funding earmarked, they will be proceeding with various works in parallel. In terms of siting, I don't think I can share with you until later, because we are still looking at this. There are something like 6 plots. 30,000 is doable. As to the specific sites and how tall to be built and how big, we are still looking at them. The heights vary from site to site. For some sites, we'd like to get on with them quicker, and there will be no piling, and they will be about 3 stories. As the first few batches are coming through, if we have a good size, like in urban areas, we would very much like to optimize the site. There may be 10 stories with lifts, and piling will have to be undertaken. If we have good sites, we would try to optimize the potential. In terms of the operation for light public housing, the rental will be packed with the PRH, about 10%. I mean, we give a 10% discount. The light public housing will be spearheaded by the government. The government will be calling for tender. The operator will have to work out the sum. The rental probably doesn't cover the security and the cleanliness. In the tender document, they will have to let us know the additional sum that would be needed. There are going to be 2 envelopes, one for the quality of service. The other one is for the price tag. All right, Mr. Lam Chen Sing, please. Thank you, Madam Chairman. 3 questions, if I may. First, about the subdivided units. The Secretary referred to the tenancy control. Under the law, the landlords will have to submit the notification regarding the tenancy. You have received something like a few thousand. In Hong Kong, we have about 90,000 subdivided units. Is it a reflection of the effectiveness or lack thereof of the tenancy control ordinance or landlord and tenant consolidation ordinance? And if this is the case, what enforcement action will be taken? Will there be more publicity being mounted? We hope that this landlord and tenant consolidation ordinance will be able to help or protect the SDU units. Second, about the advanced allocation scheme. The government said on different occasions that for these housing estates, that they may not be provided with a comprehensive range of infrastructure facilities. And it is likely that they're not as convenient as the older districts. But we don't want to see the facilities to be too underprovided. So how good are the facilities? If they are in remote areas, the grassroots people will have to shell out an awful lot for daily commute, and this is a heavy burden on them financially. If the facilities leave so much to be desired, then the many of the applicants would rather stay in the SDUs in urban areas, and they will not be having any incentives to move in. So I'd like to find out more about the advanced allocation scheme and what are the facilities to be provided. Would they be underprovided? Third, I'm sure that the Secretary has been to some of the SDUs, in particular those with children living in them. They are staying in these cramped conditions to do their homework. Now, we will be eradicating the SDUs, but this will not happen in a short space of time. I think in the near future, there should be more community facilities like community halls, community centers where children can do their study there. I mean, all they need would be just a simple setting with a Wi-Fi connection and somewhere for them to study and to do their homework in. And then they would keep them away from the subdivided units. I mean, the SDUs may be there for sleeping for the kids, and they don't have to spend the whole time in this kind of cramped condition. Their quality of life can be improved that way. Thank you. Secretary, thanks very much. Mr. Lam. About the tenancy control on subdivided units, we have received 8,000 tenancy agreements under the ordinance. Indeed, it might take a bit of time for us to ramp up the publicity. I understand that the Rating Evaluation Department has a dedicated enforcement team, and they have a task force. We have also hired 6 NGO teams who will be reaching out to the SDU tenants. After the landlords have submitted the tenancies, the tenants would receive a copy. If they don't receive them, we will pursue them for them. In November, we have another round of publicity in this regard. If I may refer to the facilities for the SDUs, I pass on the message to the relevant departments. When I was working for the ASD, I understand that the LCSD libraries and the SWD facilities are indeed good facilities. I understand that the LCSD libraries are really pretty good. Now, for the advanced allocation scheme, let me briefly touch on this. Now, I'm sure that people are concerned about the transportation, and they need to take the public transport to go to where they need to go, and we will be liaising with the transport department. I said that there is this interdepartmental action group. The TD is represented on that group. We certainly will be exchanging information with the TD for arrangement to be made. For the other facilities, some will appear at a later stage, like the shopping facilities. They may have to walk a little bit longer for the market. and the market in the housing estate may not become available until the second phase, and there may be a gap of a couple of months at most. But in any case, we will liaise with the relevant department, and not least the transportation. Mr. Tang Fei, Madam Chair, thank you. I've got two questions. Now, this is the Subcommittee on Poverty Alleviation. Now, what objective do you have in terms of alleviating poverty by way of public housing? According to Paragraph 7 of the Long-Term Housing Strategy, the ratio between public and private housing would be 70-30. So the majority of the people are actually living in the public rental housing, maybe traditional or the light public housing. 27-30% of the population are living in the PRH, and we have, let's say, 400,000 people living in SDUs. Now, we probably cannot reach this split of 70-30. How do you arrive at this split? Now, you're trying to alleviate poverty by way of public housing. Does it mean that you're trying to house these SDU tenants into the public rental housing? Is this a housing that is still in existence? Second, now from the government's paper or the Secretariat's paper, there is no mention of the financial side of things. Now, the FS keeps telling us that there is some risk of structural deficit. Now, with this shift from 60-40 to 70-30, financially, how sustainable is it going to be? Secretary? Madam Chair, thank you. Thanks very much, Mr. Tang. According to our understanding, we did have a report on the poverty situation. The public housing is really instrumental in, to alleviating poverty. 260,000 people have been lifted out of poverty through rental housing. And the poverty rate has been reduced by 3.8%. So this is a really meaningful task. Mr. Tang has got a point there. Indeed, previously, the split between public and private housing was 60-40. Now it is 70-30. According to the long-term housing strategy, this ratio will be here to stay. We certainly did have regard to the inadequate housing. In the long-term housing strategy, we look at the new demand, the new household, the inadequate housing, and also those who were displaced by redevelopment. We look at all these different factors, and also the students who may need to have housing needs. So according to the long-term housing strategy, the demand for the coming 10 years would be 310,000. We have enough land identified for 360,000, so there is a bit of a buffer there. The demand is 310,000. The land available would be enough for 360,000. So in 10 years' time, with all these initiatives, we would be able to measure up to the requirements as referred to in the long-term housing strategy. So in 10 years' time, those who have a need for public housing will be allocated with public housing. Any further points, Mr. Tang? Yes, Madam Chair. What about the financial situation? Will this massive change from 60-40 to 70-30 be sustainable? Right, Madam Chair, the Housing Authority has been very cautious. Financially, we do have sales unit in the public housing. We have the GSH, we have the HOS, and they do derive some income. But we have to strike a proper balance there in terms of public rental housing, whether we push up the rent. We have to consider the whole picture. Certainly, we will keep an eye on the situation. At the present moment, the situation is healthy.
Next, Mr. Stanley. Thank you, Madam Chair. Secretary. I have three questions. First, regarding poverty alleviation. We have been using a traditional approach to look at poverty alleviation policies, and we consider our housing policy when coping with poverty alleviation. If there isn't a fundamental change in our policies, we won't be able to alleviate poverty effectively. I understand that the government is trying to speed up public housing production in various areas or in different aspects. We think that we should adopt a targeted approach in poverty alleviation, meaning that there should be dedicated personnel in looking into this area. I wonder if there are new poverty alleviation policies to be proposed by the government so that we can look at the role of public housing supply in poverty alleviation. Also, on public housing and transitional housing policies, can you more clearly explain to the public, with LPR, would you continue to develop transitional housing units? If not, how are you going to use the relevant land? Well, with LPR, would the waiting time for traditional public housing be the same or even longer? Well, you have one policy, and I wonder, with that new policy, you can still manage to implement the other policies effectively. Also, in Guangdong, on the mainland, in the Greater Bay Area, there are a lot of vacant properties, and they are of a very cheap price. I wonder if the government would consider purchasing some of these properties for the provision of residential units for elderly people in Hong Kong, because, as I know, a lot of elderly people in Hong Kong, they would like to move to the mainland after they retire. However, the government has never responded to this question. Secretary, please. Thank you, Mr. Ng, for his question. Perhaps I will talk about the differences between traditional public housing, light public housing, and also transitional housing. We are implementing these three types of public housing units in parallel. For traditional public housing, they provide public housing units using long-term supply land. But for various reasons, there is sometimes greater supply of land, but there is sometimes less supply. So for long-term public housing projects, there is less supply of land. For traditional public housing, in the next five-year period, we'll be able to build 128,000 public housing units, and in the following five-year period, 230,000. So within the coming 5 years, if all the long-term supply of land is in use, how can we boost our supply of public housing? That's why we came up with the idea of light public housing. That is, we use the short-term land for light public housing. In the long term, this land may have other development use, for example, for community facilities. And these lands perhaps are currently being used for public works or public works construction sites or car parks. So we thought we might as well use these lands for light public housing. That is to solve the short-term housing problem using light public housing. And in the past, we have been using short-term land for providing better accommodation. And we have some 20,000 units, and we have already got the funding of $11.6 billion. For transitional housing, in the past, there were some smaller plots of land, and in each project, we were able to provide some 400 units. We hope that we can identify or find bigger plots of land for light public housing so that we could achieve a greater effectiveness under this project. As for purchasing properties in the Greater Bay Area, I think we need to consider whether the elderly people can adapt to the life there. Well, domestically, when people move from one district to another district, they already have certain concerns. And elderly people usually feel more comfortable with districts that they are familiar with. So we have to look at the idea in a more holistic manner in terms of whether elderly people can adapt to such a new living environment. Thank you, Secretary. Next, Mr. Frankie N. Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, we are talking about poverty alleviation today. Of course, public housing plays a very important role for vulnerable grassroots families. But there is also young people that we need to think about. For those who are young and they may not be able to rent housing units in the private market, they, after they graduated, they may find it very crowded if they go back to live with their parents. Well, there are certain measures under HYAB, but I wonder if the Housing Bureau also have measures to help young people. Would there be LPR suitable for young people to help them get onto housing ladder? Thank you, member. Mr. N was right. Under HYAB, there is the youth hostel scheme, and they use hotels or guest houses to provide temporary housing for young people. For LPR, there are also one person, two person, or even 4 to 5 persons units. We understand that for family households, they may prefer living in the urban area. As for the new territories or in the rural area, young people may not mind moving into those areas or living there because they may enjoy rural life. So we will provide one-person units under those projects once we have identified suitable land for implementing these projects. For light public housing, it's for those who have been waiting for public housing for 3 years, and we will issue letters to them to invite them to apply for LPR. If they wish to apply for one-person unit, they will get into the queue, a one-person unit. I have a follow-up question, Secretary. For LPR, for a single young person, after 3 years, they will be eligible to apply for light public housing. So they'll be able to stay in light public housing unit for some 6 to 7 years before they can actually purchase their own homes. Thank you, Mr. Frankie M, for the period or rental period for light public housing. If needed, we will extend the relevant period. But as I said, the land we have identified are for short-term use. But for long-term use, there may already be some development plans for those lands. And we'll see how we can make use of the lands under different projects. Secretary, I was asking for a young person as an applicant who waits for public housing. It will take that person a long time. Does that mean they'll have to wait for 10 years? Because they could stay in light public housing for 3 years. Thank you, Mr. An. It will depend on the period in which the land could be used. If needed, for example, for a specific plot of land, if there is other planned use for that piece of land, we will make other arrangements by then. That means if there is other planned use for that plot of land, that tenant will have to move somewhere else and rent a residential unit in the private market. It will depend on the specific use of that plot of land. We're looking for a rental period of 5 years now. If there are other available lands, we will apply for rezoning to extend the rental period or extend the use of land. Next, Mr. Bill Tang. Speakers off the mic. Is the mic turned on? Sorry. Well, Mr. M and Mr. Tang asked questions in a more macro perspective. Well, there has recently been a TV drama about people trying to get onto housing ladder, and it shows the problems faced by grassroots families or households. So if Secretary, you have time, you may want to watch the TV drama. So going back to my question, we should learn from Singapore on their housing policies. It is they take a landlord-led approach or landlord-oriented approach. With 70% of the land used for public housing, that's what we were talking about. We're not only referring to public rental housing, but also take into account subsidized sale flats. But if we follow the approach of Singapore, these flats cannot be resold. Should we head towards this direction, given that people have to wait a long time for public housing, and this really suppresses the productivity of the relevant households, and a small group of them may not declare their actual income. So after they have successfully got into the housing ladder, with their children having grown up, well, I believe that for a family who has gained home ownership, their children may be in secondary schools. And after their children have graduated, and if the whole family joined the workforce or are in the workforce, they may exceed the eligibility of staying in public housing. So the society has to devote resources to also take care of elderly people who have been living alone. So I wonder if the government has thought about formulating the policies which are landlord-oriented instead of tenant-oriented. With a, for example, 800 square feet unit, perhaps it can house several generations of families. How can you solve the problem of some tenants who try to suppress their productivity just because they want to get onto the housing ladder or gain home ownership? So this is perhaps a long-term target that you need to work on. And also, I have been talking with Dr. Chao Wing-san, and it was back in the 1990s. And by then, the housing society, there was a post of liaison officer. And for those who have not been able to pay for their rent, and the liaison office would pay attention to them and perhaps provide referral services. And this is sort of a role that takes care of poverty alleviation. A report was done then. If you want to provide further assistance to them, this could be one of the approaches that you may take.
Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Tang. You talked about this TV drama, Get On A Flat. I also watched that myself, and it shows that people are terribly concerned about housing. You talked about owner-oriented market. When we did the long-term housing strategy, we switched the ratio from 60-40 to 70-30, that this split may change as the supply of housing changes. Immediately before us is a long waiting list for PRH. Many people have been on the list for a long time, so we're keeping this 70-30 split to mainly provide the PRH. Now, this 70% includes the GSH as well, and this is also part of the housing ladder to own their own homes. And the other is the HOS. Now, as the pie is getting bigger, people would have more HOS units available for purchase. So we will keep an eye on this split as land supply is becoming more readily available. We will certainly consider whether there is a need for change. You talked about the liaison officer a moment ago. I've been to a number of housing estates to visit the managers. They have their heart for the residents. They're not simply providing the management services. They're providing a lot of heartwarming services. And I'm sure that part of their work would be like what you said, the liaison work. As to whether there is any further room for consideration, whether we should tweak the system, certainly we will consider that. Mr. Michael Look. Madam Chair, thank you. Well, I do recognize the work put in by this term of administration in terms of housing. As President Xi said, people really want to live in bigger space. The government has put forward the quantity, but how can we improve the housing qualitatively? Now, this is very much the aspiration of the people. My question is the abuse of the PRH units. Now, there is a case which is widely documented in the media, that this JR King, Mr. Kwok, said that he's got a unit in Yau Tong, but he's not living there. He's actually residing in Cheung Chau. his unit has been made available for someone to live in. Has the Housing Department investigated this particular case? And also for cases of this nature, how to actually go about doing it? You should check the units. I mean, normally how you check is to knock on the door, and you don't really go any further than that. Another scenario is there is very much a wave of immigration, and a lot of people were living in PRH units. Have they surrendered the units after immigration? Maybe they are not doing well enough in other parts of the world, and they're still keeping these PRH units as insurance. Now, let's say if they emigrate from Hong Kong, the children would be taken out of the schools, and they also have the MPF. If they are emigrating, if they claim the MPF, would you check whether they are still living in these PRH units, or have they surrendered their units? We are concerned that they emigrated out of Hong Kong, and they're still keeping these rental housing units. Is the administration doing anything about this in this regard? Secretary, thanks very much, Mr. Lok. About the qualitative enhancement, in the policy address, we talk about enhancing quantity, speed, efficiency, and also quality. Now, we are setting a minimum size for the newly built flats. For those completed in 2026-27, we set a minimum size. At the moment, we don't have any room to do that because of the land supply issue. We need to enhance the size at a later stage, but there is an undertaking that they will be 26 square meters for subsidized sale flats. Now, for PRH units, it is going to be 21 square meters. So this is similar to the subsidized sale flats, other than the 1 or 2P units. So it is 21 square meters for PRH units. In terms of abuse of tenancy, we are just as concerned as Mr. Lok, the PRH units or the resources should be equally or fairly distributed. If people are abusing the resources to the detriment of others, that would be unfair. I don't propose to go into minute detail about this, the way that we deal with this, because if I talk too much about them, I will render them ineffective. We do have a liaison with the team, and I'm sure that we can get hold of the specific information and deal with it. If we receive complaints from different sources, we will follow up on the complaints and conduct investigation. The case that the member referred to, I'm not going to go into that here, but suffice to say that any complaints that come our way, or any information that comes our way, we certainly take it seriously, Mr. Lok. Now, there are some immigration families that have to be investigated, and there are also many people who are driving luxurious vehicles, and they are living in the PRH units. And I hope that you will share with us the number of cases that are recovered because of these. Well, you can submit a question in the council meeting, and that will benefit us all. Right, my turn now. Now, you're going to build 360,000 public housing in 10 years' time. How many of them are actually PRH? How many GSH? How many HOS? How do they? How are they divided? right? Madam Chair, 360,000. We follow these 70-30 split. 70% are the GSH and also PRH, and the 30% are the HOS. As to the number of GSH units, it will depend on the sale situation. Well, Mr. Tang's question is also important. What is the financial situation like at the Housing Authority? What is the fiscal reserve? Each PRH unit costs you something $1.5 million, is that right? Madam Chair, what is the HA reserve at the moment? And second, each PRH unit, is it $1.5 million to build one unit? Do you think that the Housing Authority would be able to cope financially? Secretary, let's not talk about the sizes of the units, and let's just talk about the unit in general. It cost us $500 million or $600,000 per unit. Also cheap. Well, we can do it really inexpensively. There are no frills kind of unit, bare shell unit. If you take the construction floor area, the average square meter is $9,000 to $10,000. It is not expensive. As to the reserve of the Housing Authority, we haven't come prepared for that. We don't have the information with us. But as I said, when we consider the rental increase for the PRH and to what extent should we put up the rent? Now, during COVID, there are some commercial tenants who have been spared, who have been waived the rental to tide them over the difficulties. We have to look at the financial situation of the HA. We have to bear in mind the number of housing to be built. The GSH will be sold, we derive income, but still we have to tread carefully. At the moment, the financial situation year on year is in a healthy state. The cash flow is in a healthy state, but we will certainly pay attention. Well, you talk about $500,000 for a PRH unit. Are you merely talking about this size of 21 square meters? It doesn't include all the other facilities that will be provided, is that right, Secretary? Indeed, just the unit. Now, this is a ballpark figure. I have included the sizes of the unit. Of course, the sizes would be different in terms of costing. It is something like $570,000 to $650,000 per unit. Now, for the light public housing, the government officials have been going to all length to put people in housing. But I'm sure that it's going to be difficult in terms of implementation. There are many who have been seeking help. Now they want to have a priority in rehousing. Some of them are in difficult financial situation. They have sick family members, but they would decline the offers many, many times over because of the inaccessibility. If you send them to the remote areas, it would not be easy. Now, what about the operators? Are you talking about the NGOs, the lighthouse operators, or charitable organization, or what are the operators? Thank you, Madam Chair. We are working hard on identifying the sites. Indeed, we do have some constraints. We try to identify sites on Hong Kong Island, in urban areas, extended urban areas, and in the NT, quite inevitably, we will have to identify more in the new territories because there are more land plots available. We have six plots. As I said, we are still shortlisting the better sites. As to the operators, we are thinking about the non-profit making organizations that have experience in transitional housing, or some management companies can join hands with the NGOs and put in the bid. We also welcome that. We will spell out the service requirements in terms of cleansing, security, and the population intake, exit, removal, and all the rest of it. There will be a score system. If they put in a good bid, we will give them the higher score. So we don't rule out any combination. We do not confine these to a non-profit making organization or NGOs.
I have some more questions, but I'll get into the queue again. Next, Mr. Vincent Chang. I think over the past few years, the LASHCO has been working on various aspects. First, transitional housing and the cash allowance scheme, and also the tenancy control on subdivided units. We welcome the government's continued efforts on these fronts. I hope that the following policies will be implemented, including the transitional housing and light public housing. For the 20,000 light public housing units, you have to take into account when you come up with a comprehensive policy. Well, before rolling out light public housing units, how can you ensure that there will be a full intake? I think there are some concerns on the light public housing projects in terms of government's coordination efforts with non-government organizations to ensure that there will be more people living in these units. I think the government should not rely only on NGOs to do the publicity work. The government has to work on it as well. Secondly, when we talk about public housing, we have been talking about eliminating subdivided units. I think the government should come up with a roadmap for that, especially for inadequate subdivided units. I think the government have to do something about them. Well, there haven't been any legislations to regulate these inadequate subdivided units. The Development Bureau can perhaps help with it, and you may want to liaise with the Development Bureau. There are some really inadequate subdivided units in areas such as Shamshui Pool. Can you first eliminate the subdivided units in these areas or districts? Well, when you are a recover residential units, they try to relocate the residents. Well, can we help tenants of inadequate SDUs move to somewhere else first? Secretary, please. Well, thank you, Member. Thank you, Chair. Let's talk about transitional housing and light public housing first. We place importance to both. There were some 5,000 units, and this year we have some 1,000, and in total 7,000 units provided to the needy. And a number of nonprofit organizations have been offering their help, and we appreciate their support. For transitional housing, by 2023, we should be able to see a peak in terms of the supply, and all of them should be able to be completed by 2024. As for public rental housing, we are trying to seek funding from LASHCO. Well, it usually takes time for the foundation works, and we may be able to roll out the first batch of 1,000 light public housing units by 2024, and by 2025, we'll roll out in another batch, and we'll see a peak in 2026 in terms of the supply of light public housing units. So transitional housing is really playing its role in terms of offering another option to tenants. For transitional housing units tenants, they are given rental subsidies. And for light public housing, tenants are able to rent these units at 90% of the market price. So we're not going to give further subsidies to these tenants. For transitional housing, the units may be smaller, and there may be several hundreds of units. And they'll be able to build on smaller plots of land, so they're usually located in urban areas. And they're usually quite popular among applicants. In my view, I think it provides an alternative option in terms of its quality or quantity. For inadequate subdivided units, every time we see that there are people living in it, we feel disheartened. I have already communicated with my colleagues from the Development Bureau, and together with the Housing Department, we will see how we can eliminate these SDUs. There are, however, difficulties, because we have to identify sites to be able to provide a better living environment for those tenants who are currently staying in those SDUs. So transitional housing and light public housing may be an option for these SDU tenants. And then we'll look into how we can enhance our effort in regulating the inadequate SDUs or make an improvement. Next, Ms. Rebecca Chen. I would first like to thank Secretary and her team for implementing or proposing light public housing units in terms of the supply. Well, we are talking about poverty alleviation in this panel meeting today. So we're not only focusing on boosting supply of public housing. Instead, we need to think about how public housing can help alleviate poverty. If you look at our working reports of this panel, public housing is among all the policies most effective in terms of its ability to alleviate poverty. That means we have to revise some of our previous legislations to help alleviate poverty. Some applicants have to wait for a long time to be able to move into public housing. As Mr. Tang said, a lot of these applicants, they refuse to work because they want to be eligible to stay in public housing. So there is a conflict that we have not been able to resolve. And for younger people, they do not want to see a salary increase because that would make them not eligible to apply for public housing. So this is something that we have been trying to solve but unable to find a solution for. So how do you help young people to increase their salary, but at the same time be able to apply for public housing? This is one problem that we have to solve. Another thing is what we think about reforming our policies. As mentioned by Mr. Chang, we have transitional housing, but we also have to look at the problems with SDUs. Well, starting from this January, the government has implemented the tenancy control on SDUs, but we also have to look at the level of rent of SDUs. No matter how hard you work on transitional housing or light public housing, you're not able to build them in one day. And while people are still waiting to move into public housing, they have to stay in SDUs. So will the government be willing to tackle the issues to offer assistance to SDU tenants, or perhaps give your priority to those who are living in really inadequate SDUs. Otherwise, you will go back to identifying sites and so on without actually alleviating poverty. Secretary, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Member. On the conflict that you mentioned about, I think we have to work on the supply of public housing first. And then it will help bring about changes. Well, we still have a long waiting list in terms of public housing. If we relax the eligibility, then there will be more applicants waiting for public housing. But if we have sufficient supply of public housing, and within the next 10 years, if we look at the demand suggested or projected by long-term housing strategy, then I believe there will be more room, as suggested by members just now, adjust the ratio or supply of public housing. So I think right now we have to first focus our efforts on supplying public housing. As for the level of rent, we are gathering information on that. And the landlords or the owners concerned will have to submit forms and information about the rent under the tenancy control of SDUs. Well, we have to pay attention to different areas. With transitional housing and light public housing, I believe the rents for SDUs, especially those who are inadequate, I believe there would be a change in the level of rents in the market, and we'll have to think about how we estimate the rent in SDU markets. Well, in the coming rounds of Q&A, we have Ms. Doreen Kong, Mr. Bill Tang, and myself. Now, Junius Ho.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, this housing supply is a long-standing problem in Hong Kong. Secretary, you are facing this problem now, and your predecessor was also facing the same problem. And the future secretaries will also face the same problem. Every year, we provide 30,000 public housing units. Well, as long as you're 18 years old, you are eligible to apply for public housing, so you'll never be able to meet the target you set. People always think that public housing or the supply of it is a panacea to everything. And now you have the 70 to 30 split in terms of public housing and private housing. Well, you were asked how much it costs to build a public housing unit. And you mentioned about 500 to 600,000 for each. And you were also asked about the financial status of HA. And I looked up the relevant information on the internet. Well, which project is most profitable is the HOS project. Well, from your operational model of the HA, you have about $13 billion on reserve. HOS projects are most profitable. Shopping arcades are also profitable. And car park projects are also profitable or making money. If you look at it in a pessimistic way and focus on the problems of SDUs, well, while you do that, you should also monitor your other projects. and the CSSA scheme and etc. Well, you have been deceived by many people. You may be aware of it or you may not. And secondly, from the demand for car parks or demand for public housing, you know that people are not that poor in Hong Kong. I'm not objecting to your policies or initiatives. I'm just saying you should think about ways on how to help the poor people fundamentally. You were competing with the private market in the past. If you let private developers do it, they would earn a lot. So I'm now making a suggestion. HOS projects could be a solution. PRH should be of a temporary nature or temporary solution. And also, how many people are living in SDUs? 190,000 approximately. We have different types of SDUs. Well, you may not be familiar with it, but I would like to know how many people are still living in squatters. 40 years ago, we have already been talking about eliminating squatters. But still, we still have some 400,000 people living in squatters now. Do you have the overlapping figures? You should be able to master this information. Well, we don't encourage people to live in squatters or SDUs because it's not human. Well, it's hard for people or tenants living in SDUs to, for example, renovate their living environment and so on. So when you tackle the SDU problem, you also have to take into account people living in squatters. Well, Chinese people always attach importance to a good and comfortable living environment. If there is a policy to tackle SDUs or squatters, that'd be great. Well,
Secretary, thank you. Thank you very much for your comments that HOS is a good way out. So when we look at the LTHS, I would say what we consider the ratio. Abuse of PRH units, I addressed this before and I would take this really seriously. We carried out the asset check. We do have a dedicated team. We also have the retired disciplined officers who will be helping us in collecting evidence. When we put together the LTHS, those who are living in inadequate housing, the number is 127,000. And some of them are living in industrial buildings in these subdivided units. Mr. Ho, if I may add one tiny little point, Madam Chair. The HA reserve is 13.9 billion. HOS, you get a profit of 7.3 billion. Now we have 13.9 billion reserve, and the HOS is contributing a profit of $7.3 billion. That's some information from the web for 2021. Thank you very much, Mr. Ho. Ms. Doreen Kong, 4 minutes for the second round, please. Also on the financial resources, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, you raised a very good question. Do we have enough resources to cope? Mr. Ho also has a point. I've been looking at the financial situation of the HA. Indeed, You have an income of close to $20 billion. But we have to bear in mind that the half is devoted to the upkeep and administration. Each year, the money that we have available for public housing construction production is $10 billion. Secretary, you talked about half a million for each unit. I heard 800,000 per unit. Now, assuming that it is cheaper now, 600,000 per unit. If we spend this $10 billion for the production, we can build 15,000 units with this $10 billion reserve. Now we have to spend $40 billion versus $10 billion in reserves. There is a shortfall of $30 billion. If we have to build or keep up with the production for 5 years, we need $150 billion. Where is money going to come from? I don't doubt for a minute your determination and reserve to address housing problem and to alleviate poverty, but you don't have a deep enough pocket, Madam Secretary. Madam Chair, I've got a very good question there. I've been observing the budget of the Housing Authority. We don't really have enough money if the government doesn't inject money into the Housing Authority, or if we don't issue debt or issue bond, it would be difficult for you to get it off the ground. We may have a grand vision. You may give really a good hope for the public, but we will not be able to complete or cope with this financially. In terms of PRH or light public housing or the cash allowance, this is predicated on the households. How many young people in Hong Kong who are in poverty, they are not eligible for public housing, they're living in subdivided units. Many of them are residing in industrial buildings. How many people, young people, who are mired in poverty in Hong Kong? They may have high hope, but they're not able to achieve the high hope. How are you going to address this problem, Secretary? Well, this is a subcommittee on poverty, so I haven't come armed with the Housing Authority's financial situation. If necessary, I think we can supplement the information later on. As to the young people, in terms of the light public housing, all along we have to care for the elderly and the families. We accord higher priority. But for transitional housing or light public housing, we do provide the 1P units for the singletons to apply for. When we issue the letters, we would let them consider. There may be some families that will not prefer a certain location. Maybe some elderly folks or some young people might wish to move to these locations. So we will try to render assistance to young people in this regard. Mr. Bill Tank, Madam Chair, like a member said, that this is a subcommittee on poverty alleviation. We have to help the SDU dwellers. We have the ordinance in place. Now, how is it implemented? I think what is more important is to look at the bigger picture, and that is the housing policy or the PRH policy. Is it really conducive to the alleviation of poverty in Hong Kong? I think there is an academic consensus that if I would deal with the poverty in a family situation, it would be far better. In some households, they have three generations living under the same roof. So my question is our housing policy encouraging bigger families or multi-generation kind of family? The second issue is the productivity. Some people are trying to artificially suppress their productivity because they want to keep within the eligibility. Third, by putting people in the rental housing, will we encourage people to make savings? We are trying to help the SDU dwellers to provide them with the adequate housing. This is very much a community consensus. But I think we ought to spare some thoughts about the issues that are raised. Are we able to achieve these targets? Would this be family friendly? Will we encourage people to save or achieve savings? Can we release the productivity instead of curbing the productivity? Now, all these questions that we put are pretty similar. I think you should get the global picture, Secretary. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you very much, Mr. Tang. Our policy is to assist the elderly. And indeed, a household would be given priority, the family would be given a higher priority because we encourage people to have their own families, and we should accord a higher priority to families where there are kids. We should provide them with better housing. Of course, it is all about a balancing act. Some members mentioned the need on the part of the young people. So when we allocate the light public housing, we do have the 1P unit for the singletons. Savings. Now, there is some policy researches conducted. If we can provide places of cheap rental, and if we can provide the housing ladder and the units are at a discount of the market rental, like some of the housing HOS units that we're selling for half as much as the market rates. Now, this will encourage savings and also the land creation, the stable supply of PRH and HOS and so on. All these are the policies of the Housing Bureau. We're going over the time. Mr. Stephen Ho for the first round, 5 minutes, please. Madam Chair, thank you. I heard from a number of members who talk about the relationship between rental housing and poverty alleviation. Now, there are many cases of young people who are making application for PRH. They're poor enough, but they've been on the list for 8 or 9 years and still get no offer. Like Ms. Chen said, they don't really want to have a pay rise so that they can keep within the eligibility ceiling. I think the government should consider whether there should be any adjustment to the mechanism. I heard that the applicant will have to be subject to a means test, and they have to update the government on a regular basis. I think when they are on the queue, there might be a midterm review, and every 5 years maybe. I think you should take into account the inflation and also allow them the opportunity to get on the queue. I mean, like Ms. Yan Chen said, people don't really want to have pay rise because they don't want to be rendered ineligible. Now, if these young people have been waiting for 10 years and they're still on the waiting list, they are really in difficulties. They don't have much in the way of productivity. I think for them to improve their lot, we have to improve their housing situation. Now, they are not on the housing ladder, but they're not eligible for PRH. Now, those who are living in the PRH are having more disposable income than those who are living in private housing. So the government should allow them to join the list, but if they are on the queue for 5 to 10 years, there should be some adjustment to their eligibility. Second, like Mr. Junis Ho said, there is a problem with squatter huts. In the last term, I did submit a motion for debate. If the government doesn't have any development plan in a particular location, I think the squatter areas should be kept on, because they are living in constant fear of being demolished. If they get demolished, these squatters would have to buy a property in the market. There are many of them. I've looked at the figures. You have demolished 8,000 or 9,000 every year, and that's about 5 or 10% of the housing units. If they are using the wrong material, if they are occupying more land they should, that's on the wrong side of the law, but this is not their liability. I mean, it's a legacy from the colonial government, and they were allowed to build these squatter huts in the old days. And the squatter huts that were allowed there by the government at that time, now every year, I mean, we had Typhoon Mangkhut, Typhoon Hato, and the squatter huts that were demolished, were damaged, and you have to insist that they use the same materials, but for safety's sake, they sometimes would need to reinforce the squatter huts by putting in some more bricks. And if you do not change the law, they will be regarded as unauthorized building works, and they will have to be demolished. I think the government should really consider implementing a freezing scheme, that you try to freeze them there, and they're not allowed to have any more unauthorized building works, and they should be tolerated continuously. They don't have enough publicity, and I do have a lot of cases that have to be demolished by the government, and the government is forcing them out of the way. They may be given a grace period of about a month, and the government will be pushing them and try to drive them away from the squatter huts, and many of them are suffering from mental problems, and this is really getting in the way of the housing supply, and we're not getting any further with the poverty alleviation. So the government should really consider doing something about it. It's like the Chinese medicine, you have to look at the holistic situation. Thank you.
Zhe Kang.
Secretary, do you have any response? Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Ho. Member was right. All the problems, they are interconnected. You have to first create land, and then there's land resumption, clearance, and other arrangements that have to be done. We have been working with the Development Bureau, and in the preliminary stage, they work with the Lands Department on these procedures. Regarding the issues mentioned by Mr. Ho, we will reflect it to the relevant department and the Development Bureau to see how we can tackle them. Land creation is difficult, and we have an actual demand for public housing. So different departments and bureau have been working hard to cope with these problems. As for the vetting of eligibility, are there ways to optimize the relevant procedures? Perhaps I will invite Mr. Ng to respond to the question. Deputy Secretary, please. For asset review, how do we conduct the review? First of all, we ask the applicant to submit relevant information and honestly declare their income. When the applicant is allocated a public housing unit, we will do a detailed asset review. if needed, we will meet with the applicant and we will look at the information submitted. As to where we should draw the line for the income or asset from the applicant makes the application to the stage when we do the asset review, there is a difference in the relevant figures. Over the past 10 years for the eligibility, we have adjusted and to up to 70%. Madam Chair, I would like to add something. For young people, they are facing a lot of pressure to get into the housing ladder. If they do not have enough money, they may buy insurance. They have been saving money for 10 years under the life insurance scheme. If they aren't still unable to get onto the housing ladder, their life may be ruined in that sense. Can there perhaps life insurance be exempted in the asset review process? Perhaps Secretary may want to think about it. Then now is my turn. I would like to express my views on the opinions raised by other members. First, for light public housing, what is the cost of each unit? If you are talking about light public housing, transitional housing in the past was also a fundamental scheme for us. But the costs should be similar to that of transitional housing. There may be differences in terms of cost of materials. When we apply for funding approval in LESCO, we will provide more detailed information. Well, the foundation works for different projects will be different, and that would be taken into account as well when we calculate the costs. I know that people in the past complained about the toilets or living environment of transitional housing. What about the facilities to be provided by in light public housing? For transitional housing, some of the units have been completed. They are quite good. I have visited some of them. Well, there are toilets, which are not huge, but there is a partition between toilets and the other facilities in the unit. So when the tenant or occupant is using the toilet, the other family members may use other parts of the facilities, and there is cooking space. And it is safe to cook in the unit. And there are separate doors in each household. And we also have the units equipped with water heater and air conditioners, etc. As for the layout of the units, we try to keep them simple so that there can be more flexibility for tenants to arrange their furniture and etc. Well, I have visited some new public housing estates. I'm aware that some applicants had waited a long time for the public housing unit. And when they moved in, they have high requirements for the renovation. Some of them dismantled the facilities to rearrange the layout. Is that permitted? Like, would you hold or conduct a survey to see how the residents would like the layout of the housing unit to be? Well, for kitchen doors and the main doors, well, kitchen doors is the fire escape door, so there is a chip implanted in it, so we would remind tenants not to dismantle it. As for sinks and basins or other pipes, well, as you know, sometimes we have to test the water quality, and so we have to ask the tenants to use some qualified
pipes or forceps. So we have currently planned to arrange basic facilities in these housing units. But from an environmental perspective, we hope that tenants would use the existing facilities equipped in the housing units. We are trying to come up with different proposals with our colleagues now. We try to keep the design simple and to have basic facilities that allow for water testing or fire services installation testing. Well, now we're thinking of adopting MIC approach and have some of the parts or components prefabricated in the factories. So perhaps in the kitchen, there can be some basic cupboards installed. But that could be difficult because if the tenants want to renovate the housing units, they may dismantle it. So we're still thinking what kind of proposal would be the best arrangement. Thank you, Secretary. Then Mr. Holden Chow.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have one suggestion to start with. For public housing, I'm sure you have already received a lot of our comments. We have been talking about marginal cases regarding the income of the tenants. Well, if it is just a 300 or 500 differences, sometimes the departments are quite strict about the review or asset review. Of course, you have ways to tackle these situations. Perhaps the tenants would talk to their boss or supervisors to lower their income in order to satisfy the requirements of being able to live in the public housing units. I wonder if you can exercise discretion in these kind of marginal cases. If the income is perhaps exceeded by about $200 or $300, can you exercise your discretion or handle these cases in a flexible manner? If you have ideas on how to handle these situations, please let us know. Another thing I want to mention is about SDUs. For SDUs, in my opinion, handling SDUs or eliminating SDUs should be our priority in terms of poverty alleviation. I know that, Secretary, you have paid visits to a number of SDUs, and I myself as well. Some of the SDUs are in very poor condition. So if you can help tenants of these SDUs move into transitional housing as soon as possible, that would be great. So perhaps you want to think about giving priority to offering help to tenants of these SDUs. Also, is there a timeline for completely eradicating SDUs? This is what we've been talking about too. And Secretary, you may also want to think about if there is enough supply of transitional housing to help grassroots families get onto housing ladder. And at the same time, there may be another group of people moving into SDUs. You may want to think about the responsibility of owners or landlords of these SDUs. They have to pay a price because we do not encourage people to live in SDUs. But we do not have other better solutions in the short run. But in the long term, if you want to solve these problems, then you may want to think about the responsibility of owners and landlords of SDUs. This is what I would like to express. Thank you.
Madam Chair. Secretary, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chow. Regarding income or asset review, I understand your point. Very often, if you set a line, then there are often marginal cases. I understand that we want to handle these cases in a more human approach. As to how they should fill out the relevant application forms, our colleagues would render assistance. As for SDUs, I agree with what you said. With light public housing, first of all, we want those who have been waiting for a prolonged period of time to get onto the housing ladder as soon as possible. People who are on the waiting list may be facing different problems. Some of them are currently living in an environment not as bad as those in the SDUs. And we want those who have been waiting for 3 years to have another option while they're waiting for public housing. I believe this can effectively help tackle the problems faced by tenants of SDUs. As for regulation of SDUs and what price owners and landlords should pay, we will look into it with relevant departments. Thank you.
I'm the only one here to put questions. You say you don't have the housing authority's information here with you. However, the housing intervention is a good way of alleviating poverty. So we are very concerned about the financial status of the housing authority. Tens of billions of dollars have been recouped for this purpose. We are concerned about this. Indeed, public housing would prevent people from living in inadequate housing, and this is a good means to reduce abject poverty. But it seems that there is very little in the way of upward mobility. Are people able to create wealth? People are curbing their own productivity. They don't want to have any promotion because they want to keep within their eligibility. And the demand for public housing will be ever increasing. PRH will alleviate poverty, but this is not the only means. The development of industries in Hong Kong would be able to encourage people to have upward mobility. If people can get a pay rise of $2,000, and if they stand to lose their PRH eligibility, they would rather not have it. In Silicon Valley, there are many success stories, and there are so many entrepreneurs. Why did they bother living in the PRH? That the economic base is too narrow, and in Hong Kong, and also the private housing is too expensive. So I think to reduce the demand for PRH, I think we have to develop our economy and make it broader in the different range of sectors, and we should encourage better upward mobility on the part of the young people. And the private housing should not be sky high like it is at the moment. So these are my views. I think Ms. Yan Chen or Mr. Vincent Chen Cheng talked about the subdivided units. We did discuss this. Mr. Frank Chen didn't have the statistics. How can we control the starting rent? The SDUs, depending on the orientation, whether they are air-conditioned or whether they are better than others, it would be there would be different rentals. Just like stamp duty, I think you can introduce a bill And once this is introduced to the council, you should freeze the level. This is achievable. Of course, the government council will have to look at the details to guard against any judicial review. Now, we did do this before with regard to the stamp duty, and once it is introduced to the council, will go into effect. Otherwise, it would be hard for us to stop the escalating rental in the SDUs. Mr. Frank Chen didn't really want to do it, but I think you have to look at the trend, the trajectory of the rental in the SDUs. You have to put on a thinking cap there. Madam Chair, we certainly consider this. We still have a bit of time. AOB, let's discuss our agenda. Thank you very much for coming. Members, this committee was formed in June, and we're supposed to finish our work within 1 year. And so far, we've discussed the impact of PRH on poverty alleviation. Members raised other issues like the children in poverty, youth in poverty, the Secretary for Labour and Welfare would like to talk to me about the agenda items going forward. Ms. Chen, I did express my views before, and I'd like to say again, we have been talking about the existing policies. We haven't got any new policies to alleviate poverty. It seems that we are sticking to the same playbook to help the poor. Of course, I welcome the policy secretaries to be here, but I think we have to break new grounds. They may not be implementable straight away, but we should have some new ideas. If they're sticking to the CSSA or the school fee remission, or we may be just here talking about the adequacies or otherwise of the existing policies, it would be hard for us to break new ground. So we're stuck in this kind of situation. It seems to be that we are discussing the existing policies. So it depends on whether they have anything new. The policies may be pie in the sky, but they still have to consider new ideas. I think it's Mr. Stephen Ho, am I right, who said that people can't really take out an insurance because that will take them beyond the eligibility limit. And people have been working for 5 years and they're still on the waiting list, and they may be $500 too rich, but this is not allowed. So I think we have to consider how best we can resolve this issue. And they're merely talking about how they're implementing the policies as best they can. All right, point taken. We'll follow up on this. Mr. Ho, I go along with Yan that it is our mission to alleviate poverty and to eliminate the extreme situation. But it seems that it is no different from having a housing panel meeting. I think we seem to be talking about old wine in old bottle. So we are talking about a housing policy today, and I raised that issue of the squatter huts. Indeed, in the old days, there were problems, and now they are overshadowed by the subdivided units, but squatter huts remain to be resolved. Indeed, there are many PRH tenants who have been there for 30 years, and they have accumulated a lot of wealth. Indeed, they have accumulated vast wealth. They've been living there for so long. They started off saving and scheming, and they are 67-year-olds, and I mean, out of compassion, we don't really want to chuck them away. And they are wealthy tenants, but I mean, it is difficult to resolve. And there are so many people who have amassed vast wealth in the PRH, and they have improved their lot. I mean, how do you deal with them? Now, there are suggestions that they should get on the housing ladder. If you ask me, I'm paying $2,000. I've been living there, I mean, albeit in a shabby state. I don't really want to move. So we're stuck with this. People really want to have a decent life. They don't want to move out of their lodging. And you keep producing the PRH, and you have to look after them for life. And in some cases, some to hand down the units to the next generation. If you cannot resolve the problems, I think you have to deal with the squatter huts as well. If you let them stay there for some time longer, then you can take the stink out of the situation. So when we look at the poverty situation, we cannot lose sight of the squatter hut policies. The squatters, squatter hut dwellers, and they're living on government land, and they can do a bit of farming, vegetable farming, and they may want to spruce up their own dwellings without contravening the law. I think leaving them there can be helpful. Well, the government officials don't have to be worried about them occupying the site for life. I think there ought to be some kind of policies there. Mr. I'll make it brief, please. It's about time to finish. I think the Lands Department is very aggressive to these squatter hut dwellers. They don't really enforce the law as aggressively in the face of the well-off people. Madam Chair, you made a point a moment ago about the starting rent for the SDUs. There are some SDUs that are really in good condition, to vast expense. They have a good fire installations. I think we have to strike a balance there. I'm not saying that they are wrong. I think we have to make sure that there will be a balance between investment and the returns. I think there should be some starting rent. Right, with the starting rent, I mean, you don't necessarily have to suppress the rental. All you need to do is to freeze them. Yes, I'm not arguing against this. Now, there are so many SDU dwellers. If the number is increasing, you have to do something about it. In my younger days, there were 7 people living in 300 square feet. And I mean, if you keep improving the condition, there is no end to it. I think we have to review the standard. We have to devote our resources to the poor in order to resolve the problems. Mr. Ng, when you talked about this flip-flopping policy flip-flop, what the policy address and talked about targeted poverty alleviation, I think we have to use this as the guide to push the government to change its own mindset. Now, you talked about the specific targets. Now, the government has rolled out the Strive and Rise scheme, and they have to identify more targets. If the poverty alleviation policy is not fundamentally revamped, then you probably need to conduct a survey in the community to identify those who are most in need in order to be sufficiently targeted in your scheme. So how should we assist people in a more targeted way? It would be far better than what they're doing at the moment. It's no good for you to help the squatter or the SDU today and somebody else tomorrow. There should be some targeted approach. Yes, indeed, we have to approach the SWD or the welfare, the LWB. Vice Chair, Madam Chair, first of all, it is a pressing issue. Towards the end of the year, the Poverty Commission will publish the report. Now, there are so many limitations with regard to relative poverty. I think we have to change the definition. I heard that there is a reformulation, a reconstitution of the Poverty Commission. What sort of talents are they going to be roping in? And like Mr. Stephen Ng said, the policy address talked about targeted approach to alleviate poverty. I suspect that the government hasn't got any ideas who should be assisted first and what arguments do they have. I think they would need to lean on this committee to tell them what groups or what individuals need assistance ahead of others.
Thank you for your views. I will talk to the Secretary of Social Welfare Bureau. Based on the views suggested or raised by members, I will ask the relevant bureau to make a reply, and also including enforcement questions of enforcement on squatter huts. And I'll also talk to Mr. Sun of the Social Welfare Bureau to come up with a definition of poverty. Thank you, members, for attending the meeting.